know, the topic for today is linking asana, pranayama and meditation. Is that right?
Yes.
So, that's yoga is supposed to have different aspects. We got a goal, we got a starting point. So, depending upon where we start, one has to go through a process. Yoga is a process. So, some are born yogis, they don't have to go through the same set of procedures that we have to follow. There are some, you know, who are lifelong yogis, who go through less rigorous process. People like us, who after we are dissatisfied with the way life is going, and we are looking for, is there anything else we can do? Then yoga offers certain definite procedures, and the only thing is that we have got to start from an earlier stage. So this is what we have got to understand. There is nothing like the same yoga that can be applied to everybody else, but it is necessary for everyone who does yoga to know what the goal is. Unless we know what the goal is, the goal may be different. You know, if you are a bhakti yogi, the goal is slightly different. If you are a raja yogi, the goal can be slightly different. On the other hand, if you are a jnana yogi, as mentioned in the Upanishads, the goal could be slightly different. Ultimately, some people say all the goals are one and the same. Only thing is you look at it differently. So whatever be the ultimate goal, whether you are a bhakti yogi or a jnana yogi or a raja yogi, What they basically say is that you have got to prepare yourself well. Unless you have got a proper preparation, just because I am desirous, you know, I want to become a yogi, that is not sufficient. They say that you have got to follow certain procedures. The reason why you have got to follow certain procedures is we have got to make the necessary changes in our own self, you know. Physical changes, physiological changes, the changes that has to take place in the mind. All these things will have to be, and then the system of yoga takes care of almost everybody. Only thing is we must know where we enter into yoga. So according to the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali, the yogis are divided into three levels. First one is known as the Uttamadhikaris. You know what is the Uttamadhikari? Uttamadhikaris are those who are the highest level yogis. They are considered to be born yogis, you know. If you have read the Bhagavad Gita, it says that if you do yoga and then if before you are able to reach the goal, unfortunately one reaches the end of one's life, but still all the yoga that you have done does not go to waste. You know, you are born in yogi's family or whatever, you know. The whole idea is all the karma, good karma, the yogi karma you have done does not go to waste. So there are many people who have become exceptionally great yogis, but then they are not able to achieve the goal, whatever be the goal. But then when they are born in the next janma, they have the necessary wherewithal. They are able to go through the last stage of their yoga journey. Yeah. What about people like us? Who, because we get, you know, we think about it, we look at the way things are happening. Whatever we do, we don't seem to find satisfaction. We do something here, something goes wrong somewhere else. I try to plug the hole there, something else goes on. Right through the life, we keep on trying to fix things. We try to fix things, and then what happens is we get old. That's all what happens. We are not able to make any progress whatsoever. We are temporarily happy. We are happy for a short period of time, and then, you know, something happens. This constant change. I'm never happy continuously for a long time. I can't rest on my oars. You know, I do everything, and then I have to keep on doing stuff because I'm absolutely, I can't really rest. So So when, you know, when I'm in that kind of a, I have everything else, you know, I'm reasonably successful, I have done everything that is to be done, I got a, you know, I'm not talking about people who have got lots of problems, I'm talking about people who are reasonably, what do you call, God has been nice to most of us, but still I'm not happy, still there is a certain amount of an undercurrent of unhappiness, you know, undercurrent of unhappiness. So such people start slowly getting into, start looking at things, few things like yoga, you know, whether it will help me. So I am at the, such people are called the entry level yogis, you know, entry level yogis. I get into yoga, you know, I want to get started in yoga. There are billions and billions of people who are not interested in yoga. You know, either they have not heard about it, or they do not know the value of it, or for that matter, they are still busy trying to find out, you know, some way or other so that they can, what you call, plug the holes. But, you know, they're still busy with that. There are some people who think, okay, no, it's not working, let me see whether there is something else. And then they start looking into yoga. And then even once you enter into the, then we have three groups of people, the entry-level yogis. Then there are people who are called lifelong yogis, you know. I'm not able to reach the ultimate goal, but still, I have decided, you know, I've been doing a lot of things. I've been this. I've done this. I've done that. I've done that. After doing all these things, I find that I'm not, you know, I'm not able to find that satisfaction. You know, I've been looking for. I'm getting older. Okay. So such people, as I told you, are the entry level yogi. So the Yoga Sutras, which is the basic important text of our yoga is concerned. Yoga Sutras divide all those people who are interested in yoga into three groups. As I mentioned to you, first will be the Uttamadhikaris, the second will be the what do you call, Madhyama or middle level Adhikaris, and finally we got the entry level yogis. You know, we are making a beginning. What is the difference between these three classes of yogis? The first level, entry level yogi, you know, sorry, the top level yogi, as I told you, has got done enough yoga, so the, what do you call, they have got the necessary samskaras. You know what is the samskara? Samskara means they are able to do most of the things that I am not able to as a yogi. Okay, supposing, and some are genius, you know, at the age of 3 or 4, they are able to play the, what do you call, play the piano, or they can so do some enormous mathematical problems, they are able to do that. They have got the gift, we can't call them genius. But in India what they say is that it is all due to the previous samskaras. You know, they had done it in their previous janma, so they have got it already. Likewise, the yogi also, if you had done a lot of yoga in the previous janma, so they start on a much firmer footing. In the Bhagavad Gita, they divide the yogis into two groups. One group they call it Yoga Arudha, the other group is called Yoga Arurukshu. Yoga Arudha are those people who are able to use yoga without any further preparation. They can straight away go along the path of yoga, they can discover. The word Arudha, you can understand, Arudha is like mounting a horse. You know, if you want to go in the olden days, if you want to go to place X from place Y, what do? They used to ride a horse. You know the way, you know, mount a horse and then, you know, you'll be able to reach the place. So like that, the bond yogis have this capacity. They know how to ride a horse. They know how to ride the horse called samadhi in yoga. Samadhi is the vehicle. Samadhi is the, what you call, vehicle through which they are able to, what you call, make that final journey they want to make. Whatever be the goal, we'll come to the goal later. That they know what the goal is. If I want to reach a goal, I need certain things. And that capacity to, only thing they have got to do is they have got to travel the distance. They have got the means, they can do it. So how to go about doing that are mentioned in the first chapter of the Yoga Sutra, the entire first chapter. They say what are the various things they have got to do. So if I am able to get into samadhi, I can straight away do that. So in the Yoga Sutra, the first chapter talks about these people, what they should do. And many times when you start studying the Yoga Sutras, you will find that, you know, they all appear to be, what shall you say,
Very difficult?
Very difficult, yes. And sometimes we start even wondering whether, you know, whether it is just real or some speculation, you know. That's what many of us start thinking. Anyway, the first chapter is for the top level yogi. In the Bhagavad Gita, they are called the yoga arudha, arudha, once, you know. Then the Bhagavad Gita also talks about yoga arurukshu, arurukshu. Supposing I, you know, after studying the Yoga Sutras, you know, having gone through trying to spend all my time trying to find some satisfaction, I know I'm getting old, I'm 73, I'm sorry, 74. Then I decide that, you know, whatever I've been doing is not going to help me, I got to try something else, and then somebody says, oh, you want to try yoga, so I've started trying yoga. So, but then I go, I mean, as I mentioned to you, I go to the, what do you call it, I want to travel, reach the end of the goal of yoga, so I go and find out, and they say that, all right, here is the horse, you know, you take the horse, you can reach the goal. I try to, you know, mount the horse, but it doesn't, it throws me off, you know, I'm not able to, I don't know how to mount a horse. Do you know how to mount a horse?
Yes.
Some of you may, but most of us don't, you know. Most of us don't know how to do that. So just as the bond yogi is able to, you know, go along the path of yoga by using the samadhi capability, I don't have this capability. So Patanjali in the second chapter, okay, starts with saying, how can I acquire that? How can I acquire that particular capability? How can I get into samadhi? According to the Yoga Sutras, you know, samadhi is not the ultimate, that samadhi is not the goal. Samadhi is the means. Samadhi is the means by which you are able to achieve the goal. So the first thing I got to do is, if I have the samadhi capability, yes, you know, I can use my samadhi capabilities to understand the entire universe in its various various manifestations. I will also be able to understand the true nature of my own self. They call it purusha or pure consciousness. I will be able to see the distinction between the nature of my own self, pure consciousness, and the nature of my mind. And then that means I need enormous concentration. I should be able to, what do you call it, remain focused for a considerable amount of time, so that undistracted by the outside world, I'll be able to focus my attention on the various aspects of Prakriti. I will be ultimately able to see the distinction between the nature of Purusha and Prakriti. And then once I'm able to see that, my mind will be completely satisfied, because my mind is able to know my own true nature, and then I will stop, you know, doing the prompting work I've been doing earlier. Mind is going to be completely satisfied. So this is what I should do. This is what I should have been doing. So for that to happen, first of all, what should I do is, just like, you know, our friend had to learn how to mount a horse, I have to learn how to get into samadhi. In the Bhagavad Gita also they talk about this, you know, yoga, arudha. But then doesn't those, most of the, what you call Vedanta texts, most of these texts, they talk about the goal, you know, they talk in general terms about how you should reduce your involvement with the outside world and all that. But the specific technique, the specific methods by which you will be able to achieve the samadhi and make progress, it is very clearly catalogued, very clearly written only in the Raja Yoga, the Yoga Sutras. Okay? And then they also tell you on a step-by-step basis what should we do. You know, what do we get by each of these steps? Even though you may not be able to achieve the ultimate goal, they will be able to tell you what you get by going through each and every step. So from that point of view, you know, the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali become very important, because it not only talks about the goal, but also tells you about all the steps that one has to take before I'll be able to reach the goal. Am I making sense? So this is the most important. That's why Yoga is not only, yoga has not only a philosophy, but also it gives you the means by which you will be able to achieve the goal. And again, as I told you, they are able to divide all the, what they call, the aspirants into three groups, depending upon your, what you call, depending upon your skills, the yogic skills you already have. Right. Now, if you want to, you know, if you want to get started on yoga, suppose I am 60 years old, I've just retired. What age will you retire here? 65? Okay, 65. Okay, 65. Then I find that, you know, everything else, you know, I want to, the thing is, when I'm 65, I'm not so strong as I used to be, you know. There are lots of unfinished problems, you know, things I have not been able to solve. unfinished desires, you know, lots of these things are there. You know, I got a very limited time. So then what, for such people, with people with a lot of pain, yoga offers one yoga called Kriya Yoga. What is maybe Kriya Yoga? Kriya Yoga is a few activities which are different from the way we go about doing our normal activities. So they say it is called Kriya Yoga, made up of three elements, Tapaha, Swadhyaya, Ishvara Pranidhana. Is it okay if we go into the technique? Tapas, Swadhyaya, Ishvara Pranidhana. Tapas means what? Tapas in practical terms, according to my guru, you know, it's a very broad term, but in this context, tapas will refer to try not to engage your senses, you know, in too much of the outside activities. Try to have a slight control over all the activities of your senses. So there's in practical terms, we said tapas will be two things: mitahara, mitabhashana. Mitahara means you start, you know, ahara means whatever you take inside. Normally we refer to the food, but here it is used in a broader context, broader sense. Mitahara will be whatever you take from the outside world. Whatever I hear, whatever I see, whatever I eat, or everything that I put into my own system from the outside world, it is called ahara. Mita means moderate. Don't be right from the morning up to the night I go to sleep, I constantly engage my attention, you know, engage my senses with outside activities. Right in the morning, right side activity starts at home. The moment you get up in the morning, they start deciding, discussing about what should we have breakfast, what should I do, what should I do with this laundry, or what should I do with this, you know, lots of things. They are all outside. So far as I am concerned, they are all outside, you know, for each one. Just because it is a family matter, doesn't mean that it's not outside. And then it goes on until you go to bed and go to sleep. So the right through, our mind is engaged with outside activity. There is very little I do. I'm talking about, not about yogis, I'm talking about the general populace. So what happens? So this is called mitahara. Mitahara means you start reducing. Whatever you take into your system. If you don't have any time left, sorry, if you are very busy, if you got a spare time, what do? Immediately get your computer and then, you know, you start posting in Facebook or, you know, Twitter. Or if you have more time, you start ringing up somebody, you know. You can always find something from the outside world to engage your attention. You don't have time for yoga. This is how things go on. So here, but then the first thing that anybody who starts on yoga, such a person will have to do is to reduce the involvement of the outside world. Involvement in the sense, try to get less and less from the outside world, mita. And then mita ahara will also mean sattvika ahara will come to that little later, which take those things from the outside world which are going to be conducive for your yoga practice. Okay, supposing I take, strong food and all that, you know, if I take eat that, you know, it's going to sit in my stomach for six hours. I want to do pranayama, I want to do meditation, I can't do, you know. So there are certain things, certain ahara which are conducive for yoga. There are certain things which are not conducive for yoga. And then you also take whatever you require only moderately. You don't take too much of that. Okay, this is one, mita ahara. The second thing they say is mita bhashana. So you don't know what is mita bhashana? Bhashana is to speak, you know. Don't talk too much. That's one of the important things for me. That's one of the olden days the yogis used to keep quiet, keep silent, you know. Of course, I have to speak, you know, I keep talking here. But once I stop teaching, I normally try to keep quiet. I don't, you know. Anyway, the more you talk, then what happens? You know, when you have time, you ring up somebody and they say something, you give your opinion, and then he gives his opinion, goes on. Ultimately, you come back and see it was absolutely, you know, it was just a strain for your mind. You know, it's not really helping you. So anyway, so mitahara, mitabhashana is tapas. Then swadhyaya. Swadhyaya is the next term. What is my swadhyaya? I cannot go on the path of spiritual, you know, yoga and spiritual life without opening a page of any of the yoga books. You know, of course, I read yoga books, but then all the yoga books are written by the contemporary yogis who themselves have got very little experience in yoga. You know, I look at four or five different books. I take one paragraph here, one paragraph here, and they X says this, Y says this, Z says this. What does it mean? What do you say? That's more important. You know, that kind of material we normally don't get. So Swadhyaya refers to studying the original text. Suppose you want to know more about yoga, already read some of the old texts like Hatha Yoga, Pratipika, or Raja Yoga, because we know what yoga is all about only from those texts. There are good commentaries available, you can do that. So tapas will refer to two things, mita ahara, mita bhashana. Then thirdly, so mita ahara and mita bhashana, both of them refer to the tongue. That's why my teacher used to say jikhva chapalya. What means jikhva chapalya? Jikhva means tongue, chapalya means weakness. The tongue has two weaknesses. One, it keeps on blathering. The other weakness is it wants to taste a lot of food. So both of them are mitahara and mitabhashana. That's why both of them, tongue will have to be brought under control. This is the first. Then we got swadhyaya. Study the text. If you anything that you want, suppose you want to become a medical doctor, you've got to study the various books, you've got to study anatomy, physiology, and number of other texts you've got to study. But then how is it if you want to be a yogi, you don't have to study anything. You have to study. So how many of us who practice yoga spend time studying the text? We don't normally, isn't it? Yoga is practice, that's all. You go, how do you do yoga? You go to a yoga studio, practice yoga, do asanas for an hour or two, come back, and then we have more time. Yes, I'm doing more yoga. What do you do? More asanas. I don't study anything. I have absolutely no time to study anything. Swadhyaya refers to study. Every subject, has got a foundation. I've got a foundation books I got to study. Likewise, Swadhyaya will refer. So entry-level yogis must have a good understanding of yoga. So Swadhyaya, everywhere. Apart from this, Swadhyaya, you must be able to get a few books, study them, understand them. Then the third one is Ishwara Pranidhana. Ishwara Pranidhana here refers to, if you believe in God, take that help. If you believe in God, half the people have belief in God, the other half of the people don't have belief in God. And both of them are interested in yoga. Okay, people who have faith in God, yes, you take advantage of that. Ishwara Pranidhana, Ishwara Pranidhana here will refer to whatever yoga you do, the benefits of the yoga you practice, you surrender to something which is superior. You call it God or whatever you want to call it. So it is more or less like the Bhagavad Gita's Karma Yoga. So Ishwara Pranidhana here refers to. So with this attitude you start. Once you practice yoga in this particular fashion, trying to be careful about what you take from the outside world, study the yoga text, and then also, whatever activities you do, don't worry too much about the results. I'm doing this particular posture. All right, if I do it, will I be able to be on the yoga journal cover? This kind of concerns should not be there to start with. So this is minimal. We are not talking about asana, we are not talking about anything rigorous at this particular point of time. When you do this, according to Patanjali Yoga Sutras, he says, when you start doing this, the klesha started. Klesha means causes that are, the reasons why you start feeling a lot of pain. All of us are under a lot of pain. Klesha start coming down. You feel, a little more easy, the your own mental, the mental space, mental space starts clearing up, you feel more comfortable, you are more comfortable with your own self. So that is the result of the practice of the Kriya Yoga. Once you practice Kriya Yoga for some time, maybe for a few months, then what happens, you are able to, the mind is able to say, okay, there seems to be something good in this. Okay, and I have been able to study the Swadhyaya, be able to study the Yoga Sutras. Okay, they are talking something which is very sensible, but I have not been thinking on these lines. Why is it I have not been thinking on these lines? Because my father never thought on these lines, my mother never thought on these lines, all my friends, my children, everybody I know or whom I know, they don't talk on these lines. All of us talk, very similar in a similar fashion. So there is very little opportunity for me to know. Once you start studying the Yoga Sutras or, Swadhyaya, there's another way of looking at it. We don't look at life, but they're very, very, very logically written texts. So once you do that, and once you start, once you are able to find that it is possible to have some kind of satisfaction without all these outside objects. Yes, all outside objects give me satisfaction. But it is also possible to find satisfaction without all these objects. Once I am able to find that, then I get more and more interest in yoga. Then sometimes what happens over a period of time, I think I've seen that this seems to give me is more desirable. Then what I've been trying to do by, you know, running around trying to get, because there is very a limited, what you call, limited amount of what you call ananda, vishaya ananda, they call it, we can get from the outside world. Once I'm able to see the difference, then I get more and more interest in yoga. Why is it most people don't do it? Because they don't see it. The reason why they don't do it, because they don't see it, you know. Then after you practice Kriya Yoga for some time, then the kleshas, that is, you know, mind becomes clearer, there is more, what you call, there is a certain amount of pleasant space in your mind, they call it sukha. Sukha means, come means space, su means agreeable. Sukha refers to an agreeable space. The space is not about outside space, the inside, the mental space. The mental space becomes more and more agreeable. You are more, you know, you are more comfortable with your own self. So this is supposed to be the initial benefit of Kriya Yoga. Now I get, what you call, I get hooked to yoga. Mm-hmm. I get more and more interest. I want to know more. Then Patanjali in the Yoga Sutras talks about a more elaborate yoga procedure called Ashtanga Yoga. You are all familiar with Ashtanga Yoga. But what Patanjali talks about is not the Ashtanga Yoga. You are all familiar with it. In the Ashtanga Yoga, in the Yoga Sutras, there are eight steps. Eight angas, you know, eight steps. Eight steps are there. Each has got a place. Each has it. Suppose I become a full-time yogi. That doesn't mean that I'm not going to do anything else. Basically, I'm going to be thinking about yoga. I'm going to be thinking about, you know, the various ideas contained in yoga. I just want to go along the path of yoga. The first goal of an Ashtanga yogi is to get the capacity to go into samadhi. You know why? Because samadhi is the starting point for the uttamadhikari. You remember I mentioned to you at the beginning? Samadhi is the starting point for the uttamadhikari. Right now, I don't have this capacity. But by Kriya Yoga, I've been able to, free myself with lots of the, you know, distractions of the outside world. So I can, you know, devote my time fully for practice of yoga. Practice, study, you know, contemplation, everything that yoga contains, I'll be able to do that. Okay. Now let us try to understand this. According to yoga, Sankhya and most of these philosophies, the entire universe is made up of three gunas. Are you familiar with that? Three gunas? Did anybody come for the program last year when I talked? Okay. Anybody else who came?
No.
Right. Do you remember anything I said last year? Yeah. I can safely repeat what I said last year. Yeah. So we have, that is, once you start practice, you know, there are three gunas. You know, the entire universe is made of three gunas. We are also made of three gunas. Of course, there is the purusha part, the real self is something we'll come to a little later. But our body, mind, you know, the whole physical person, drishyatma deva, that you see as a self. Who do you see as a self? You see me as a self. I'm the self. You know, we ask who is Ramaswamy, you point out to me, you know, with the person, with the body, with senses, you know, so many indriyas, 11 indriyas, I got a buddhi, you know, intellect, I got a ahankara, I got an ego, I got a manas, a mind which can coordinate all my senses, I got five senses, I got five karmendriyas which I can act, you know, then I'm made up of five bhutas, five basic elements like earth, water and all that, everything is in me, all the 24 tattvas that are supposed to be, you know, they are all in me. That person is known as Drishyatma. What do I do? Now, I am made up of three gunas also. These 24 tattvas made of three gunas called sattva, rajas and tamas. Now, in the Bhagavad Gita, he says, if you are a tamasic person, you try to become a rajasic person. If you are a rajasic person, you become a sattvic person. If you are a sattvic person, try to go beyond all the three gunas. Istriganyo, Bhavarjuna. Now, Now, first of all, I must understand what is tamas, what is rajas, and what is sattva. You know, some kind of a thumb rule understanding of that. What is sattva in us? Sattvam laghu prakashakam. If you have got sattva, then sattva is dominating in you. You feel very light physically, laghutva, and prakashaka. Your mind is very clear. Sattvam laghu prakashakam. And this is the most desirable quality. Because my mind is very clear. You know, my body is like sattvam laghu prakashakam ishtam. Then if I am highly rajasic, what happens? It manifests as Upashtambakam chalanjarja. Upashtambaka means I'm restless, I can't sit in a place. You know, I keep on engaging in outside activities. They give the example of a bull. When it sees another bull, what does it do? It doesn't go for a chat, it goes for a fight. It immediately is supposed to pick up a fight. So this kind of, you know, constant antagonistic engagement with the outside world is supposed to be the general characteristic of Rajas. And ultimately tamas, when tamas dominates, what happens at the physical level? I'm very lazy, lethargic, heavy. And then at the mental level, avarana, you know, nothing gets to me. I went to a yoga lecture, first 5 minutes are very attentive, then I switched off, you know, nothing has got into my head. So when tamas dominates, that's what happens. When you, these are the three gunas. Of the three gunas, yoga wants you to pick up the sattva guna and then try to improve that. You know why? Sattvam laghu prakashakam. You physically feel light. Prakashaka, the mind is light, mind is clear. You need a clear mind to understand the philosophy of yoga or any other philosophy, other bhakti yoga or whatever it be. Anything that takes you away from the outside world, I need a sattvic frame of mind so that I will be able. Unless I am in a sattvic frame of mind, I will not be able to go along the path of yoga and reach the stage of samadhi at all. Samadhi is a manifestation of sattva. Okay. So when I start, these are the three gunas, sattvam, laghu, prakashakam. I think I forgot to mention, when Rajas is dominant at the physical level, I told you that you become restless. At the mental level, when Rajas dominates the mind, you tend to become, what happens is your mind, chanchala means it is not able to concentrate. It will be able to stay with an object for a few seconds, then there is another. This is the way we go about doing all our daily activities. Morning you get up for about 5 minutes or few seconds, you are focus on one task, then next task, multi, say a sequence of tasks with very short duration of focus, short focus activities. Now this is how, so over a period of time what happens, this becomes our habit. Once I start using my mind in this particular way, my mind becomes a rajasic mind. And on the other hand, if I allow my mind to be in the tamasic stage, as I mentioned to you. So once I allow myself to get into any one of these grooves, like a rajasic mind or a tamasic mind, it doesn't change. That's the whole problem. When I allow my mind, supposing my mind is rajasic, and then when I'm young, I keep on, you know, when I'm a rajasic person, what happens, as I told you, like a bull, I used to get very, very angry. You know, I'm very, very brittle, you know, very easily I can be broken. So what happens? If I don't do anything about it, as I get older, you know, this same characters will continue. The only change that takes place in me is that the physical changes or the physiological changes that take place. I become older, but instead of being an angry young man, I become an angry old man. That's all the change. No other change takes place because I am in the same group. That's called the same samskara as continuing. Okay. So if I'm a rajasic person, by and large such people go through life as rajasic people. Then on the other hand, if I'm a tamasic person, you know, I go through life as a tamasic person. A tamasic person, I'm lazy, you know, over a period of time. If I'm lazy over a period of time, you know, I depend entirely upon the senses to give me any satisfaction. As I go older, my senses, the acuity of my senses start coming down. So what happens? I start enjoying less and less the outside world. And there is nothing inside me which I can, you know, from which I can draw. So what happens? I become depressed. So one of the characteristics of tamas is to make you more and more depressed as you go along. Nothing will change you. Once you are, you know, if you don't do anything about it, then as you grow older, you become more and more tamasic. If you are a rajasic person, you become more and more a rajasic person. The samskaras keep building, you know. You are going along the same route. So over a period of time, and both rajas and tamas are not going to give us any, what do you call it, satisfaction. I am going to feel a lot of pain. Rajas gives pain, tamas gives, what do you call it, depression. So these two are feelings that I am not quite comfortable with. So Patanjali starts saying that you got to make fundamental changes so far as you are concerned. And yoga is supposed to be the method by which you are able to bring about the fundamental change in any person. Okay. So in the Ashtanga Yoga, which is the more complete, elaborate yoga that you find in the, you know, first thing that you got to do is You have to practice what are known as Yama Niyamas, not practice, observe. Observe Yama Niyamas. You are all familiar with Yama Niyamas?
Yeah.
Say yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes.
You know, otherwise then I will take more time spending explaining Yama Niyamas. Yama Niyamas, Ahimsa, Satya, Asteya, Brahmacharya, Aparigraha. All these the Yama Niyamas tell you how you relate with the outside world. How you relate with the outside world, you know, what you communicate with the outside world, how you treat other beings, you know, all these things are governed by the Yama Niyamas. Okay, Yama Niyamas are there. So we can say that Yama Niyamas are something, so far the yogi is concerned, Yama Niyamas are like safety nets, you know, safety nets. You know, I already started yoga and then I don't want, you know, I'll come back to it. They are like safety nets. Then what do you do? The third anga in Ashtanga Yoga is called asana. Asana practice when you do regularly, regularly when you practice asanas, over a period of time, what happens to you, you know, what happens to you, you don't know. Does anybody know what happens when you practice asana over a period of time? If you keep on practicing asanas, what is supposed to do when you keep on practicing asanas, according to the Yoga Sutras, Rajoguna comes out. You know the Rajoguna, what is Rajoguna? Rajoguna is the one which is responsible for the restlessness that you find, physical restlessness, and the inability to concentrate. And then that produces dukkha. Okay, the rajas produces that. So if you keep on practicing asana, the way it is supposed to be done, you know, the way it is supposed to be done, then it is supposed to reduce your rajoguna. And all the old texts talk about it. We take the Hatha Yoga Pradipika, one of the texts for yoga. It says, asanena rajohanti. If you practice asanas, the rajoguna comes down. All the rajoguna is destroyed. Likewise, the Yoga Sutras says the benefit of asana is tato dvandva anabhigata. Dvandva means pairs of opposite. Pairs of opposite. Supposing the temperature is, 75 degrees, I need an air conditioner. If it goes to 65, I need a heater, you know. So my tolerance is very, very limited. Whereas, you know, if I can manage with all 50 to 90 degrees, I can manage without any external. That means I am more tolerant. If I am more and more rajasic, I become very, very intolerant. Even minor things irritate me. Even minor things start irritate me. So this becomes, you know, this makes you uncomfortable. It makes everybody around you also uncomfortable. So this is the rajoguna. When you practice asanas regularly, over a period of time, you become more and more tolerant. Okay, rajoguna comes from. So this is the first requirement. The second requirement is, once you reduce your rajas, what happens? The mental space, the space, chitta akasha, they call it. The chitta akasha is now, what do you call, has less and less rajas. But the other two gunas, what are the other two gunas? Sattva and tamas. Sattva and tamas. Either of the two can occupy the space, depending upon which is more, what do you call, which is more powerful. Normally, when you practice asanas, what happens? You produce some waste products, some toxins, you know, even when you practice asana, any physical activity will do that. So, the by and large, what happens is when you practice asanas, even as rajas comes down, it also produces a concomitant, production of tamas. So, what happens immediately after you practice asanas, you feel, you know, tired, you feel like lying down, you know, you don't feel like doing anything else. But in yoga, what they did was, all right, you have done a lot of work, you have reduced the rajas for the time being, you also try to tackle the tamoguna also. So what do? They came out with a procedure called pranayama. It is quite simple. In pranayama, what you try to do is use your respiratory system to throw out a lot of the waste products in your body, a lot of, toxins in your body, whatever term you want to use. They use the term tamas. You are able to remove a lot of tamas from your system. So by working, you know, by doing both asana and pranayama in tandem, then what you are able to take care of the two undesirable gunas from the yogic point of view. One guna is rajas, which is supposed to be what you call taken care of by a good, you know, well thought out practice of asanas. Then you got the pranayama to reduce the tamo guna. Once your rajas and tamas both of them come down, then what do you have? The mind is now more and more of sattva. More and more so, because there is sattva is only what you call only guna that is that is not. Now you have become more and more sattvic. According to the yogis, unless you are a sattvic person, your mind cannot concentrate. The mind will not be able to remain focused. Yes or no?
Okay.
Yeah, two things. once your rajas and tamas come down, when rajas and tamas come down, the mind will have to be occupied some other guna, you know, because all the three gunas cannot go away. The mind is now full of sattva. Then Patanjali says, take this opportunity. Don't merely practice asana and pranayama and go away. The first advice will be, don't do asana alone, and then, you know, if you don't follow it up with pranayama, you have done a lot of good work, you know, you follow it with pranayama. If you do asana and pranayama together, as I told you, then what happens, the rajas and tamas come down, the mind is going to be sattvic. Then what do? Your mind is in a better condition to meditate. Because samadhi is a condition of the mind. Now I want, what do I do? Now we go to the next stage, where you use your sattvic mind, and then by practicing the, whatever way you call it as meditation, now we'll come to that a little later. By practicing meditation, as mentioned by Patanjali, over a period of time, the sattvic samskaras get strengthened. Sattvic samskara means, you know. So, after you practice your asana and pranayama, you are supposed to sit down and meditate so that you become more and more sattvic. So, over a period of time, what happens? I keep on practicing asana and pranayama. They keep on practicing asana and pranayama, what happens? The rajas and tamas come down. Then, immediately after that, I sit down and meditate the way they ask you how to meditate. Then if you do that, then what happens over a period of time, because you have engaged your mind more and more in the sattvic activity, those samskaras become strong. In the earlier case I told you, if you don't do anything, if you continue to operate as a rajasic person or a tamasic person, over a period of time you continue to be a rajasic and tamasic person. In fact, a stronger rajasic or a tamasic person. Now I want to change the whole thing. I cannot find a satisfaction. I cannot find the mental peace that they are talking about, until and unless I am able to reduce the rajas and tamas from my system. And everybody talks, even the Bhagavad Gita talks about rajas and tamas. Only in yoga they tell you how to do it. So how do it? By practicing asanas you are able to reduce your rajas. By pranayama you reduce your tamas. And then sit down and start your meditation. Once you start your meditation, over a period of time, the sattvic samskaras, the habit of using, then what happens after some time, there is a transformation in you. There is a transformation in you. They call it parinama. Prior to that, all the parinama that are taking place are subject to merely time and circumstances. Here, this is a more fundamental change. What you are trying to do is, I have got the capacity to meditate. I got the capacity to go into samadhi. I got the capacity to go into the ultimate goal of nirodha. All those capacities are there in my mind. But I have not given an opportunity for the mind to go along this particular path. By keeping myself completely engaged in the way we are going about our life, we don't give the opportunity for the mind to find its own capabilities. Does it make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But then we need a system. You need a system by which this can be done, and yoga is supposed to do that. Right? There is also another question. If you practice asana pranayama, and then after you practice pranayama and sit down and meditate, okay, so let us say this is what's supposed to do. Then why do you want to do yama niyamas? They also have got a place. Yama niyamas are like this. Supposing you practice asanas, what happens to you? Tell me.
Rajas
comes down. Okay. Then if you practice pranayama, what happens? Tamas comes down. Then after you practice your asana and pranayama. Then if you start going out and then, go to Burger King or over a period of time, you exercise for 2 hours and then you don't diet at all. It's, whatever good work you have done, you waste it by doing something which is, if you don't count your calories, or the hard work you have done. So here that is very similar thing happened. You have done a lot of work to reduce the rajas and tamas from your own system. You've been able to reduce the systemic rajas and tamas. But then what happened? By not following yama niyama, you get a lot more rajas and tamas from the outside world. So because you are not completely free from, we are connected to the